comes married to the man, she bears his name, bears his seed, carries his offspring, carries his prosperity, carries his nature. Everything that the man is, the man does no longer have it for himself. They become one. So marriage is oneness. It's not two individuals trying to work things together. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Whoever the man is, whatever the man is whatever the man becomes.
Amen.
That's why if you don't push your husband up, then you know that you are going. If you try to go up outside of him and try to build yourself, you only shortchange yourself, because no matter how far you go, you will still be a part. A cup can be half full or half empty. When the Bible says the two shall become one, it means that the man is not complete without the woman is not complete without the man. It didn't say they are not competent, it said they are not complete. Because most of our read more complete music is competence. No, God is not saying they are not competent. You can be competent as a woman without a man. And you can be competent as a man without a woman, but you are not complete. In other words, if you are achieving 30% result as a man, when you become man, your result should go higher. See, one shall chase a thousand, two shall put 10,000 in flight. So I can have all my maximum strength as a man, individual, as a person alone, without my partner. All my maximum strength will always still be half full.
Wow.
My highest potential is still half full. And the woman's highest potential is still half full. And so when they come together, they become one. That's why they are one. They are not two, they are one. Because half and half combined together becomes full. Praise the Lord. This is not very simple anyway. But if you have that understanding, now in this scripture, it says your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. In this union, we didn't bring anything to the union than ourselves. Praise the Lord. Our maker is everything that we take. We come in as his bride. And he comes in as the groom. And the beautiful part of this relationship is that we came in empty-handed. He came in full.
Hallelujah. Amen.
So automatically, when you become one in Christ, what God is saying is that you take on my identity. You take on my nature. You take on my name. You take on my authority. You take on my influence. You take on my ability. You take on my wisdom.
Amen.
So you can automatically say that I died and I rose in him. When a man becomes a new creation, all things are passed away and all things become new. And all these things are of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if I'm communicating.
Amen.
So the maker of the whole earth, the one who are now one with, has no limitation in the earth. Let me describe him a little bit. He has access to every place in the earth. He sees all things, knows all things, have all things. He has all ability and is willing to share all his ability with you. Because as a bride, you don't have anything but to reflect the glory of your husband.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Women understand how to spend your husband's money very well. So you understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
As a bride, as the bride of Christ, what automatically becomes, so you don't have an identity outside of Christ. You don't have a nature outside of Christ. You don't have a definition outside of Christ. So to know you is to know Christ. So what does that mean in real life? What does that mean in literal terms? It means that you don't have anything to worry about. Because he has everything that you need.
Amen.
Christ is not a means to everything. Christ is everything.
Amen.
I wish you can understand the depth of what I'm saying. is not a means. Christ is not an add-on to your old life. Christ is the replacement of your old life.
Hallelujah. Amen.
He didn't come to endorse you, to pass you to continue the life you're living. He came to end it and give you his own.
Hallelujah.
He came to give you everything that he is. He came to make you have dominion over the earth and not just dominion in the earth.
Amen.
There are different between having dominion in the earth and having dominion over the earth. If you have dominion in the earth, it simply means that you are in competition with every other person. It means like Apple is in competition with Samsung. Apple has its market, Samsung has its market. And they are all striving to get the market of everyone. So every year they invented and reinventing themselves. And so every time they bring out a product to that every other person will be interested in to beat the market and to make more profits. That is dominion in the earth. That's not what Jesus came to give us. He came to give us dominion over the earth. In other words, what he's saying is that you are not limited by the limitations on the earth. You are like a god over the earth.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That is what it means to be married to your maker. You lose your humanity and embrace his divinity. You lose your identity as a human slave and became a God being.
Amen.
You know what the word Son of God is? The word Son of God means that you are an offspring of God. And whatever flows in God flows in you.
Amen.
The difference is that you took a human form.
Mm-hmm.
That is the difference. So when Jesus called himself the Son of God, people took up stone with God. They knew what he meant. How can you say you? And that's when you look at the scripture, you always say, how can you, being a man, call yourself God? You only say that I'm the Son of God. But from us who are Gentiles, we didn't understand why the Jews were so angry. They understood what he meant. He was saying that I am an offspring of God.
Yes.
That whatever flows in God flows in me.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever God can do, I can do. That is what our marriage is. It's not a religion. We have been called to be married to one who has no limitation. We have been called to marry to one who cannot be bound or afflicted. We have been called to be married to one who does not lack wisdom. We have been called to marry to one who cannot live in fear, who is not afraid of anything. We have been called and married to one whose authority flows in us.
Hallelujah.
You know what authority is? It means the ability to determine outcomes.
Yes, that's right.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You are not a slave.
Yes.
You are a son.
Amen.
The next verse says that for a brief moment. Verse 6, sorry. For the Lord has called me like a woman forsaken, grieved in spirit, and had sore, even a wife who would have mourned in youth, when she is later refused and scorned, says your God. So, your calling, God called you a son, forsaken. God called you a son whose people have been trying to find his identity in life. That's what the word forsaken means. The most important and the most critical thing that we suffer on earth is an identity. I keep saying it's an identity crisis. Because the day we lost our oneness with God, we didn't know who we are anymore. And when God was about to make us, he said, let us make man in our image and likeness. In other words, you do not look anything less than God. So if you function anything less than God, you have lost your identity. So he's calling you back into that union. He's running after you by love and pulling you to himself and saying, come back into our union where you and I become one. Praise the Lord. He says, like a woman who was forsaken, trying to find her path, trying to find her identity, trying to find her purpose, trying to find what makes her fulfilled, trying to find, you know, a lot of women trying to find suitors. I'm trying to find, is this the right man? Is this the right person for me? Is this the person I can give my time to, my all to? Is he the one that can build my dreams with? Is he the one that can build my future with? Is he the proper person to submit to? Is he the proper person that I can give my heart to? Every woman goes through that challenge. Every man also goes through that challenge. Eh? Mm-hmm. So trying to find the person to be identified with. Mm-hmm. That's what Jesus God was saying here. They were like those forsaken, trying to find our purpose. The next verse says, "For a brief moment I forsook you, but with great compassion and mercy I will gather you to me again." And when I read this scripture, I said, "No, God, you can't be the one forsaking me. God does not forsake people." Because the Bible says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the Bible says that he has never changed yesterday, today, and forever. So as I was looking at the word forsook, and I went to look at it from the root word, and I found that it was like the word forsake simply means that God is, the scripture is saying that for a brief moment, I called you back to myself. If you look at the previous verse, he says, you are like a woman forsaken. In other words, this is the only way I can describe it. Let me break it this way. In Genesis chapter 3, when Adam sinned and walked away from God, the first thing that happened to him was that he went away and went into hiding and covered himself, was trying to find cover himself. And then the Lord came after him. The Lord was looking for him. And the Lord said, "Adam, Adam, where are you?" And he said, "I heard your voice, and I went to hide myself." And so, God showed me the picture that God has always been the one looking for us. We have been the one hiding from him. Amen?
Amen.
So, it is because of the way we have seen ourselves. What sin does to you is that it gives you a wrong impression of who God is to you. It's not just more than the effect of what it does in your body and all that, but it gives you a wrong impression of how God sees you.
Mm-hmm.
And automatically shuts you away from the relationships you should be enjoying. Every child knows that by growing up, that if you do something wrong, you are the one that runs away, it's not the parent that runs away. You keep avoiding them, trying not to touch matters. Even sometimes you go out and stay until it's late in the night, sneaking in the house and running inside. I hope that they've forgotten what happened. Amen? Praise the Lord. And so, most of the time, we are so sin conscious that we think that God is against us. Sin gives you a wrong impression that God is against you. God is not against you. God came to redeem you. Can I just shock you a little bit? Do you know that sin cannot separate you from God? Relax. I know what's happening in your mind. Praise the Lord. Amen. Do you know why sin cannot separate you from God? You want to know why? The Bible says that Jesus is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Let me just bring it in the Old New Testament. Sin affects the way you see God, not the way God is. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is not movable. He doesn't change because we change.
That's right.
And if he is love yesterday, he's still love today. If he is compassionate yesterday, he's still compassionate today.
Amen.
If he is forgiving yesterday, he's still forgiving today. Are we together?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
If he is willing, if he is a God who gives unconditional love yesterday, he still gives unconditional love today. Let me shock you a little bit. Do you know that when Cain killed his brother, Cain and God still have fellowship? Have you read it in the Bible? In the Bible, when Cain killed, the first murder in the Bible, Cain killed his brother, hid him in the sand, and Cain was still lying to God. In other words, it was like Cain was taking advantage of the relationship that God had with him. I said, I don't know where my brother is. And it was not the murder that separated him from God, but murder has consequences. Don't get me wrong, sin has consequences. The wages of sin is still death. Praise the Praise the Lord. But sin does not separate you from God. It does not separate God from you. It separates you from God.
Yes.
It affects the way you relate with Him. It affects the way you respond to Him. So even if He is forgiving, because of sin consciousness, you will run away from His forgiveness. So even if He is compassionate, because of sin consciousness, you run away from His compassion. So sin robs you of the joy that you can have in intimacy with Him. It blindsides you from God. It affects the way you see God. So God is always talking. He's still talking. He's still the same yesterday. He's still releasing His goodness. He's still releasing His grace. He's still releasing His compassion. He's still releasing His power. He's still releasing His ability. He's still releasing His favor. But you are running away from it because of sin consciousness. You are withdrawing away from it. Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
And Jesus became the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. No, no, Jesus became the sacrifice that settled an eternal problem. Sin, many times we try to fix sin with temporal fixes. The Lord was teaching me a few weeks ago, and was showing me that you cannot tame certain habits. You need to be changed from certain habits. Many times you try to tame lust. You try to tame anger. You try to tame bitterness. You try to tame certain things. You can't tame it. You can't put it under check. You can suppress it for a season. That's what psychologists do. But after a while, under the right temperature and pressure, it will come out again.
Yes, very true.
So no matter how many times you try to be quiet and not be angry and not blow up, I need to put you under the right temperature or under the pressure, it will come out. So you need to be changed from within. So God didn't come.